50% of all jobs were from manufacturing. 50% of everybody that worked was in manufacturing. 37% of all jobs were the auto industry, so that's where we were. In the 40s, we became the arsenal of democracy, and our plants here produced 70% of all war materials. That went to the Russians, the British, all our allies, 70%. That's a phenomenal thing. So all our factories that were making cars were converted into war, you know, to war armament. And so we played a major, major role. After 1940s, you know, started the FHA programs, the housing programs, and what happened was that you saw the highways being built. You know, you started seeing the freeways being built. You started seeing housing in the suburbs being built. You started seeing that happening. But by the year 50, there were 2 million people that lived in the city of Detroit. It really, the explosion into the suburbs really hadn't taken place. So you had 2 million people within the confines of the city of Detroit. Very dense. You know, these houses that we have, the older homes, you have lot frontages of 25 and 30 feet. I mean, they're very narrow lots, but everybody was packed in here, and there was a lot of home ownership. Along with the 50s came the urban renewal, and you had urban renewal that wiped out urban renewal and highway construction, like where I-75 is where Black Bottom was, and you saw the elimination of a lot of poor homes, you know, more modest homes. It also wiped out a lot of things that people didn't realize had value. Like, for instance, I'm Greek, right? Before I made the announcement, but you know, in Greektown, it was a very vibrant area. It was as vibrant as any other kind of neighborhood. And what happened with urban renewal wiped out the church, the community center, a lot of the businesses, and it continued to diminish. What you see in Greektown right now is like one block that's been taken over by casinos. But in one time, it was a neighborhood like many of the other neighborhoods. So that urban renewal actually destroyed a lot of neighborhoods in the city. But that was what happened. So you had federal stuff coming down. You had federal laws that ended up impacting on the city. You know, public housing came along at that time because we had this, not just here, St. Louis, Chicago, everywhere else had public housing because the population was squeezed down so much in these cities. And so you had this federal government that came in here. And then at the same time, you had you had local governments. So we have Cobo Hall, the Civic Center that's there. That all came along in the 50s, you know. So there was the city beautiful kind of thing. And let's be a great city, and let's invest in our riverfront. And so we saw some of that happening in the 50s with, you know, the Cobo Hall complex and things like that. You know, also in the 50s was probably the last time you saw housing being, you know, any significant housing being built in the city. There were little pockets of places that were filled out on the east side and west side. Also in the 50s, you know, the private sector made a huge impact. So Northland and Eastland. And if you know Northland and Eastland, they're built across the street from Detroit, right? One's across 8 Mile, the other one's across from Detroit on the east side. So they went there, the taxes were low, they could build there. The advantage of accessing all the people that lived in the city of Detroit. So that started impacting on downtown. You know, and people talk about Hudson's, people talk about the Avenue of Fashion on Livernois. All those places were impacted tremendously by these, the shopping centers. And don't ask where they are now, because I guess they aren't, you know. And so, I mean, I don't think Northland's, does Northland still have stores in there?
No,
not much longer.
We are being closed.
Okay, so what comes around goes around, I guess. So goes around, comes around. So that was a big thing. The other thing that happened in the 50s, and we think it just happened, but in the 50s, huge amounts of industry left this city. You know, there's an article in Business Week in 1957, and they're talking about all these factories that were closing up, and they're going to Macomb County, they're going to Oakland County. So this march of industry, leaving older plant, going to new plants and building new plants, that started way back in the 50s. It's certainly accelerated by the time you get into the 60s. You know, we had on the east side, we had the Chrysler Quarter, Mount Elliott. There's these, they had plants. They had the 8 Mile Stamping, Mound Road Mound Road Stepping, you know, Mound Road Engine Plant, Huber Foundry. You had the legendary Dodge Main. Dodge Main was 30,000 people working in that plant. Can you imagine a small city like that? And it also had the neighborhood around there. So Dodge Main got old. You know, they were dealing in by the time you got to 1970, you're dealing with plants that were built in 1914, 1910. And it wasn't working because, you know, you had Toyota coming in here and kicking our butts in auto manufacturing, and their prices were much lower than our prices on cars. And so they started losing things. So these plants became tremendously obsolete. And so you found large parts of the city that were abandoned, it came to be abandoned in the city. So what happened also at that time, you started seeing the government, the federal government, you know, in terms of renewal or urban renewal and other programs were preeminent. By the time you got to the 70s, Richard Nixon passed this program called the Community Development Block Grant Program, which resulted in cities having, you know, a great amount of say over what they were going to do for their cities. So Detroit in the first year got $60 million. That's back then $60 million. It was a lot of money. So Detroit had for the first time had the ability to take public action, you know, on their own in significant ways. And they did that. There were also other kinds of tools that came along you started seeing this an urban policy emerge, and it culminated in the Carter years. I mean, Carter originated a lot of programs that helped cities like Detroit and helped them to do things. So there was a UDAG program. So all these programs were there, and what it did, it enabled a public-private partnership in a way of commercial revitalization. So you saw things like downtown Millinder Center, and you saw Trolley Plaza, and you know, most of all, you saw the General Motors Poletown plant. Enormous effort, huge effort. Couldn't have been done without the cooperation of the federal government, but it was really directed by the city of Detroit. But it was also, you know, it was, you know, General Motors could have left. You know, a year before General Motors decided to build there, Ford came to the city and said, "We want to build a plant in the city." And the people in the city looked at one another and said, "How do we do that? I mean, how do we do that? You know, we're locked in with the, you know, our built environment. Where do we put them? How do we do this? We can't do it." Well, you know, then years later, when General Motors decided they wanted to do a plant, it was like a birthday cake. Here, city, we're going to build a plant here. It's going to be here for the next 30 or 40 years. We want to do it here. Can you do it? Well, at that time, Coleman Young was the mayor, and he said, "We have to do it." And it was a great inconvenience to many people in the city. 3,000 people had to be relocated. That's pretty tough. People that were 80 and 90 years old that lived in those homes had to be relocated. It was pretty tough. Nobody wanted to do it. But, you know, it was a decision that had to be made. Shortly thereafter, down the road from General Motors, close to the river, Chrysler renewed their plant. They had their Jefferson plant was built in, I think, 1910. It was 5 stories high. Nobody makes cars like that. So that had to be all redone. So now that's the plant where they make Jeeps. Another plant over on Mack Avenue. So you started seeing, you know, I guess a conscience on a part of industry to work. We also, like in the 70s, in the 80s, you saw an imagination, maybe born out of desperation in the city, because what happened here, there were, the Downtown Development Authority was adopted in the city of Detroit, state legislation adopted in the city. Second one in the nation. California was first, we were second, thought it was a great idea. And there was the Detroit Economic Growth Corporation, because there were problems in cities, you know, working in traditional ways. That is, cleaning streets, safe streets with police, and putting out fires and all that stuff. It was clear that with the depopulation of the city and what was going on in the city, that something more had to be done. And so this Detroit Economic Growth Corporation kind of blended both the public and the private sector, and they undertook some pretty pretty important activities, and they continue to do that today. So that was like, that was, it was not just the projects, but it was the organization that was put in place to help move the city forward in commercial ways. So we started seeing things like that, an aggressiveness on a part of the city. And again, with in partnership with, you know, with Washington. That kind of came, that kind of dried up when Reagan became president because there was no urban policy. And you started seeing another thing. You started seeing a difficulty in moving forward. You had, there was a lot of, you didn't have the momentum you had before, you know, either on the public sector, you didn't have it on the private sector. We did do some great things. You know, we had a couple stadiums. We had Comerica Park, Ford Field. Those were monumental projects. But in terms of, like, commercial things, you know, the stuff that was done in, earlier in the 80s, like Millinder Center and Trolley Plaza, you know, that kind of disappeared. So you move forward from there, and you started seeing planning coming into play. So you started seeing slowly and quietly in downtown and in this midtown area, planning was being.
You know, I know, you know, people get criticized.
Sometimes you have to think about where you're going. You have to think about the past, but you also have to think about where you're going. So planning came about, and so this overnight success that's midtown really started happening in about 1990. Started looking at what we have to do, and what had to be done here was to repopulate this area. What had to be done here was to attract commercial. So now you're seeing, in the last 5 years, you're seeing all these restaurants and bars and businesses that have come here. That was not serendipitous. That was really the result of a lot of planning. And also the you started seeing coming to the fore foundations. Foundations started taking the place of the federal government in many ways. That $60 million that Detroit got in 1974 is now, I think, around $30 million in today's money. So what has happened is the foundations came in, and they saw the potential, and in fact, they started investing very heavily in this area. You also started seeing some magic happening downtown. You know, you had CompuWare come in there out of the blue, more or less. You saw Campus Martius come along. These were kind of like messages that maybe were not as bad as we thought they were. And you started seeing efforts to redo things. The Book Cadillac Hotel, the Fort Shelby, these magnificent old structures that were sitting there vacant for 30 and 40 years with trees growing out of the top of the roof. People undertook them and they redid it. The Kales Building, a lot of stuff started happening that way. And then, you know, again, you know, during that era, you started seeing, you know, while we had great public-private cooperation in the 80s and in the 70s, that kind of appeared in a different way. We used to have an organization called Detroit Renaissance. Detroit Renaissance was a planning organization as well. I mean, if you went to a meeting in the 70s or 80s, you would be sitting there and you'd be sitting with people from Detroit Renaissance. National Bank of Detroit. You know, we had hometown banks here. You know, we had Detroit Bank of Trust, National Bank of Detroit. We had all these banks. And so when you were at a meeting, you almost had to elbow your way to the table to get in between where the banks were because they were so involved with the city and its future. That kind of disappeared. We don't have any hometown banks anymore. You know, you can't go down your corner banker and ask for money to get money in here. But what's happened is you started seeing an evolution of other kinds of atypical lending that came in. And you saw a lot of people getting assisted in you know, creating businesses and being helped. It's not enough, but it's something. And there's a lot of local initiative that's been happening as a consequence of the maybe the maturity of the population of Detroit, or maybe it's also the recognition on a part of the city and the state and everybody else that, you know, we've underestimated the city for a very long time, and the market potential here is really good. It really is great. And you have a lot of people who can work. Now, you know, what has not happened is we haven't gone into the neighborhoods. You know, this model that's here in Midtown or in downtown, how do you package that and how do you take it out to the east side or to the west side? I mean, so the how do you now take this and take some of the same, and maybe it's not gonna be the same here, where you got Wayne State University, we got the medical center. We're not going to have the same factors, but you can't say that we don't have some of the same, you know, market, you know, things that can impact the market as we have here. I think, you know, we haven't really, we haven't developed the leadership nor developed the potential of some of these neighborhoods. What's happened over the years is, you know, we've declined the population. We're 750,000 people, you know, where we were 2 million. And the thing is, one time I, right here, at this restaurant back here, and I'll stop after that, at this restaurant, I'm walking by, and it was a particularly busy day at Sabah here. If you haven't been there, you should go there. And some of the guys were outside, you know, that were smoking cigarettes, that were, you know, cooks or washing dishes. And so they're outside, and I said, boy, you guys had a busy day. And this one guy said to me, he says, you know what? He said, we buy houses, we buy cars, we go to restaurants, we're just like everybody else. We're 750 people here, and he said, that's not bad. Anyway, that's it. That's my history.
Okay. Thank you, Ernie, for that really illuminating history. I want to first thank George and Nandi for convening this series of panels. And for asking me to moderate them. My name is Stephen Henderson. I'm the editorial page editor at the Detroit Free Press, the host of American Black Journal and My Week on Detroit Public Television, and also the host of Detroit Today on WDET radio. So I have a lot of jobs. I need fewer. I'm going to introduce our panel. I will ask them a few questions. And then we're going to let the audience ask questions. And the way that we're going to do that is we're going to have disperse note cards. And if you've got a question, write it down, and we'll pass them up here. And then I will read the question, and you'll get a chance to stand up and interact with the panel if you want when I'm reading your question. But you don't have to. So with that, I will start with our distinguished panel. Chris Jackson is to my immediate left. Chris is a Detroit native who once served as a Detroit City Council staffer. He also worked extensively on casino regulations in the city, and most notably, he was a former partner in the development of the Greektown Casino. Chris now serves as a partner alongside Jim Jenkins of Jenkins Construction and Queen Lillian LLC, a Detroit-based development firm. To his left is Lauren Hood, who is a community development professional and native Detroiter. While studying for her master's in community development at the University of Detroit Mercy, she developed a passion for creating engagement strategies, recognizing that longtime residents like her are often left out of the redevelopment process. By day, she serves as the community engagement manager at Loveland Technologies, a civically engaged data and technology company. She also develops programming and facilitates dialogues around race and equity issues for her LLC, Deep Dive Detroit, where difficult conversations are at the core of every interaction. Clients have included local fellowship programs, foundation staff, and various justice-centric community groups. Recognizing Detroit's rapidly changing cultural landscape, she has also become active in the preservation arena. She serves as a mayoral appointee to the Historic Detroit Commission, or the Historic District Commission, and is on the board of directors for Preservation Detroit. To Lauren's left is Ken Cockrel Jr., who in 1997 became the youngest person ever elected to the Detroit City Council. He would go on to serve 16 years in Detroit City government, including 4 years as council president and a 9-month stint as mayor after the resignation of Kwame Kilpatrick. He's been an integral figure in Detroit's development. Currently, Ken is the executive director of Detroit Future City, which seeks to implement a comprehensive long-term guide for planning and development in the city. And to Ken's left is Charles Beckham, more commonly known as Charlie Beckham. Now, I'm going to stop here and talk a little bit about that. He is my uncle, my mother's younger brother. And this Charlie Beckham is his Detroit name. Because in our family, nobody calls him Charlie. He's
That's
either
true.
Uncle Charles, or Dad, or Grandpa. But for here, he will be Charlie, I guess. He is currently the group executive for Neighborhoods for Mayor Duggan. He served in the appointive capacity for 6 mayors of Detroit, starting with Mayor Coleman A. Young in 1974. Charlie has held numerous executive positions in city government, including department director for water and sewage, recreation, public lighting, general services, etc. He's also been the city's chief administrative officer and chief operating officer, along with numerous boards and commissions. Along the way, he also found time to hold several engineering executive positions with General Motors for 14 years and operated his own management consulting firm, V Enterprises. He currently serves as board secretary for Black Family Development and is chairman emeritus of the Michigan Black Chamber of Commerce. So I'm going to start with you, Chris. And I'm going to ask each panelist to give us just sort of an overview of what the historical commercial business and economic development looks like right now in Detroit. And talk about it from the perspective of inclusion. Who's getting opportunity, who's not, and how is that all working?
Thank you, Stephen.
Yeah, you need the mic.
Good evening to everyone. Couple things I just want to mention. One, I am a lifelong Detroiter, born and raised here, and I currently still live here within the city of Detroit. So I love this city. I love the city for its past. I love the city for where we are now, and I will continue to love this city as we continue to grow and even change. As relates to economic development and where we are as far as inclusion, which is something that's very important to me. Detroiters, and I'll preface that by saying Detroiters and not necessarily putting a race tag on it. We do not control economics in this city. We do not, for the most part, own the grocery stores. We don't own the convenience stores. We don't own the gas stations. We do not own major industry for the most part. There are some African Americans and other Detroiters, I should say, who may own some industry manufacturing. But Detroiters, for the most part, do not control economics in Detroit. And so that is pretty much controlled by non-Detroiters. And so Detroiters are, for the most part, we are patrons, we're customers, we are consumers. We are renters. We are not necessarily really in control of the economic fabric of the city. There are pockets and there are other opportunities that are there where you have developers like Jim Jenkins and myself, George Anandi. You have George Stewart and Michael Byrd. On Woodward, we have the development group that developed the Gateway development on 8 Mile. There are many of those individuals I mentioned are also Detroiters. You have Ernie Zachary, who's a Detroiter, who is a major developer and has some control over the economy and economics. So one of the things that I believe is that there needs to be more Detroiters engaged in the economy and controlling the economy of Detroit by owning property, owning businesses, which in fact, if they are Detroiters, they give back and they pay to property taxes, they pay income taxes that then become part of that engine of this regrowth in the city of Detroit. I think that part of the reason is that we have many of our, many middle-class Detroiters who left the city of Detroit. They moved and they set up stakes in other parts of Southeast Michigan for a number of reasons. Either they wanted better education opportunities for their children, they felt that there was a safety issue and crime was a issue. And so many of the entrepreneurs, they kept businesses here, but they don't necessarily live here. And I think that truly, though, for this city to be a great city, we need those entrepreneurs, we need those business owners and business people to be Detroiters, because there's a different sensitivity then and a connection to the community when you own a business here and you also live here. So I think that there needs to be some type of incentive that for people who are Detroiters, that when you start talking about incentives, when you start talking about some of these programs, I think there should be a preference to people who first make that commitment to move here, live here, engage here, pay taxes here, yes, maybe have to put their children here. Those individuals should have some type of level of a preference when it comes to incentives when it, for business and economic development. I think that we should reward those who are already here or who have made the conscious attempt to come and live here, regardless of what your race is. I think it's about being a Detroiter when it comes to those type of incentives.
Okay.
Next, Laura.
Well, that's exactly why I didn't prepare what I wanted to say. So we read the questions, but I knew based on what other people were talking about, it would change my direction. What is interesting now about development in Detroit, people act like there's just one movement. Not everybody wants to go to Hopcat. Not everybody wants to work at Quicken. Not everybody wants to live in downtown and midtown. Like, I just got reminded about the rest of the city. I have a friend that does poetry, and I'm like, oh, you better get a property fast downtown if you want to have a space where you can do that at. And he's like, property's going fast downtown, but not up where I want to have the space. Like, there's a whole other set of economies that are happening here. So this is awesome what is happening here. I live in Brush Park. I moved downtown because I was attracted to, I don't know, lights, energy. I grew up on the Northwest side and I would always come downtown to hang out on the weekends and I always was like, I want to live downtown. So that's why I live downtown. It had nothing to do with all this rebirth that is happening right now. I'm excited about it, but it's not for everybody. Not everybody, we talk about programs being inclusive. Not everybody wants to be included in that mess. To some people that is so foreign and different and not what they're into, but there are all these alternative economies. There's stuff going on 6 Mile and Livernois now. Well, more closer to 8 Mile and Livernois, but there are programs up there. There are programs that initiated at DEGC, which is down here, but there are programs that are happening in neighborhoods and people can participate in those economies without having to change what their culture is. There's a particular culture of development that is happening down here. It appeals to a certain audience. That audience isn't everywhere. That audience isn't most of the city. So people talk about, oh, the city's emptying out. So we have 650,000 people here. At least 600,000 people like something different than what's going on right there. So there are just a lot of different types of economies, and I hate that there's just like one story we always got to talk about, like Dan Gilbert and Hopcat. Right. Meanwhile, I just went into a new restaurant today. I wish I could remember the name of it. Chef Gabriel on Livernois, Joe's something cafe, but I had never heard of it.
Cuzzo's.
No, not Cuzzo's. See, you wanted to be Cuzzo's. I went there. It wasn't Cuzzo's. It's across the street and south. Yeah. From where Cuzzo's is, there are all kinds of new businesses up there that nobody's even talking about. And the people up there could give two craps about being included in what is going on right here. And I know that in general, it seems like just one group of people is in it. There are lots of different kinds of people in this economy. If you want to get in, there are ways to get in. You do have to have a certain kind of education, I think. You need to have a certain kind of capacity to socialize with different types of people. There are certain things you need to have going on for you to get to participate in that, but you can find out who the what those are and who the people are to connect you to those resources if that's the game that you want to play in. But I actually just, I don't know, I'm more excited about what's going on other places now, even though I live right down the street.
Yeah, I think Chris and Laura really did such an outstanding job laying that out. There's really not a whole lot that I can add to that. I will share though, the perspective that I bring to the table is kind of interesting. Speaking not as a former elected official or speaking as the head of Detroit Future City, but really speaking as a resident. The neighborhood that I and my family live in is actually Woodbridge, which is a historic district just to the west of Wayne State University. So some people actually consider us a part of Midtown, but we're really not because we're on the west side of the Lodge Freeway. So we're close, but not really Midtown. And it's interesting being in that area because we've lived in that neighborhood now for over 20 years. And when we first moved into the neighborhood, there really wasn't a whole lot around us. But one of the things that attracted me and my wife to it was the fact that it was a very, very diverse community. It was diverse ethnically, it was diverse economically, diverse even. I mean, it was the kind of neighborhood and still remains very much to a certain extent. It's the kind of neighborhood where you got straights, you got gays, you got doctors, lawyers, you got garage bands, college students, crackheads, police officers. And in some cases, they're all on the same block, literally. I am not joking. And it's an interesting dichotomy, too, because on the one hand, we've watched as Midtown has just kind of exploded just to the east of us and seen how that area, this area really, has grown and developed. And yet by the same time, our neighborhood, we are in very close proximity to some of the poorest neighborhoods in the city of Detroit. As a matter of fact, that zip code, which is zip code 48208, at least according to some information that a friend of mine emailed me a couple of years ago, which I was surprised to hear, is actually one of the poorest zip codes, not just in the city, but in the entire country. So it's really interesting to kind of see, depending on which direction we go, the differences in neighborhoods. And some people would say that that really points to what's going on in the city of Detroit right now. And they'll tell you that Detroit right now is a tale of two cities, one which is thriving and booming, which is very rich and well-to-do, and another which is very poor. But I don't even know that that really tells the whole story about what's going on in Detroit. Because when we just break it down as saying, well, look at Corktown, look at Midtown, look at downtown, which is booming, but then you've got all these other communities which are suffering, well, that also ignores the fact that you've still got a number of neighborhoods in the city of Detroit which tend not to get the level of media attention that some of these other areas get, but which have been very stable over the years and which continue to be very stable, like your Indian Villages or your Sherwood Forest or your Grandmont Rosedale. So to say, to just break it down to the tale of two cities is not really telling a complete story about the city of Detroit. I think what we really got to work towards is the day when we're really just telling the story of one city, which is doing well for all people of all races, all economic backgrounds. We still got to get to that point. There's a lot more work to be done. I've also got some thoughts on the incentive issue, which Chris touched upon, but I'm not going to go there right now because I have a feeling that Steve has that on his list of questions, so I'll hold off until then.
Appreciate that.
So one advantage of going last, everybody takes all your points. So I'll try to be quick. I certainly agree with pretty much everything that everybody said. Let me just start out by saying a couple things. First of all, Detroit is going to come back. It's going to be revitalized. There's no question about it. We have here in Detroit a chance that most of us would like to get, even in our own personal lives, a chance to do it over, to start again. We've gone down to the depths. We've gone through bankruptcy, emergency management, and we're now coming out of that with a clean slate and a chance to do things differently and right for Detroiters. And it is going to change. People are coming here from literally all over the world to be a part of this revitalization and this rebirth. What Mayor Duggan has chose to look at first and out of the chute is, because the question is, well, what are Detroiters going to get out of it? What are those that stayed and couldn't leave or stayed because they just love Detroit? What are they going to get out of this revitalization? So the mayor chose, well, let me give them, first of all, better services. Because we've not gotten good services here in Detroit for a long, long time. So we looked at trash pickup. We looked at cleaning up the illegal dump sites. We're changing the streetlights. We're not where we want to be with police response time, but it's down from when we took office a year and a half ago. Fire department response is down. EMS response is down. We went into the neighborhoods where the number one complaint after public safety was abandoned homes and fire and burned out homes. So we're doing demolition. Last year we demolished 4,000 homes. And the mayor likes to tell the story, and of course, as Stephen said, this is my sixth mayor, so I've heard every mayor from Coleman Young on down make promises about how many demolished homes we're going to tear down. And all of them promised 10,000 houses a year, including our good friend, and I see Donald Robinson over there, Coleman Young. So we'll tear down 10,000. Nobody ever got close to that. 4,000 houses is the most we've ever done in 40 years in Detroit. We'll probably get close to 5,000. But when you think about it, that's a lot of demolition. We've got a lot more to go. There's probably 25 to 30,000 houses that need to be demolished in Detroit, but this is a good start. We've also looked at it from the standpoint that every house doesn't need to be demolished. We have some great housing stock here in Detroit. Ken talks about Woodbridge, other areas and neighborhoods, and they have absolutely outstanding homes, and we don't need to tear everything down. So what we're doing is demolishing those that are demolishable, those that aren't. We're trying to put people in those houses and do rehab and reconstruction of those houses. And that program is going very well. There may be some questions later about that so we can go into detail. We wanted to fight the blight. That's exactly what we did. We talk about neighborhoods. Two things the mayor has done there. And I have the pleasure of serving him as group executive for neighborhoods. So everything I do every day is about the neighborhoods. Even though downtown is a neighborhood, midtown's a neighborhood, they're taking care of themselves, but we're concentrating on the neighborhoods. And so we have district managers in each of the council districts, and their daily job is to make sure that the needs and the wants and the desires of every citizen in each one of those districts is taken care of. So we have a district manager and a deputy district manager, and that's their number one job. Through the Jobs and Economy Force, which Ken Cockrel is a part of, and Tom Lawan, who is my counterpart, is heading up, we've targeted several neighborhoods to do all of these things, to clean up the blight, to fix up the residential, the commercial strips, and put dollars and economic development in each of those areas. So we talked about Living North 7 Mile, Avenue of Fashion, East Warren, 6 Mile Corridor going over from Livernois to Wyoming to Schaefer and out on Grand River Greenfield, Grand River Southfield, Grand River Rosa Parks, which will butt up to the Woodbridge area, yep, where George has some property over there. We're doing some development things there. Gratiot 6 Mile, Gratiot 7 Mile. There are economic development activities in those areas that are targeted right now. They just don't get the news stories yet, but it's all coming. And so that's the approach that the mayor should do. Let's start from the bottom and go up. We've got a clean balance sheet. If we, in fact, can balance our budget for the next 2 years, we'll even be out from under the Financial Review Commission, which means we'll really be free to do a lot of the things that we want to do. So I think Detroit is going to come back. There's no question about that. There are a lot of good things that are happening outside of the traditional downtown, midtown, the things that we hear about. I'm sure we'll get more into the details of the whole economic inclusion piece. Chris made a lot of good points there, and there's even activity that we're doing there with respect to the Duggan administration, the whole conversation of community benefits agreements, which is pretty controversial right now. I think we're all on the same page that we believe there should be community benefits agreements. The question is, what's the mechanism by which we get there? And I hope we're got some time today, Stephen, to really get into the details of that. But there is a sensitivity to, from at least the Duggan administration, to really make sure that everybody in Detroit benefits from the revitalization of what's going on. And so far, there's a lot of data that supports that.
Okay, next question. The literal definition of gentrification is the replacement of one population with another, usually with a marked difference in the economic status of those two people. And in a city like Detroit, that's majority African American, it's almost impossible to discuss something like gentrification without talking about the disadvantaged natives who are simply not benefiting from recent developments. We're starting to hear that word be used when we talk about Detroit and when we talk about new things that are happening here. I want to ask each of you whether you see gentrification in Detroit right now, and if so, what is it that we should be doing about it? What are the things that government should be doing? What are the things that businesses should be doing to try to reverse that? We'll start at the other end this time.
Good point. You're right, Stephen. That's a popular term now. People are throwing it out. I don't see the massive gentrification that's going on, as an example, in Harlem, that's going on in Northeast Washington, D.C., in Southwest Washington, D.C., where people literally are being driven out of their neighborhoods and cannot get back into the housing and some of the developments that are there. I think to some degree that's going to happen, and it's inevitable because you just have old housing stock, but for the most part, we're making a very concentrated effort here in Detroit to make sure that doesn't happen. As an example, for any new housing project that comes up in Detroit, the mayor has mandated that a minimum of 20% of it, I don't care what it is and where it is, has to have affordable housing as a part of it. Yeah. That's unique, it's new, that didn't happen in D.C., that didn't happen in Atlanta and some other places.
it's happening here. People are living up to it. We've had some proposals presented to us that did not have that percentage, and they were rejected, or they were told to go back and restructure their proposal and come back with that in there. So there's a sensitivity to that. The other piece is that we are a city of neighborhoods. And so we're not driving people out of those neighborhoods. Our policy is to try to keep as many people in there and in their homes as we can. To give you an example of how difficult that is, as you know, the Wayne County Treasurer does foreclosures on homes twice a year. And so in the fall of last year, which would bring those houses from the time schedule to foreclosure in January of this year, 40,000 homeowners in Detroit were moving into Wayne County tax foreclosure. So that means those people were not being pushed out by gentrification. It's high unemployment, no jobs, and a whole lot of other reasons. And so we've made some concentrated efforts in working with the Wayne County Treasurer to try to keep people in those homes. So the mayor went to Lansing. One of the things you can enter, prior to the latest bill being passed, you can enter into a payment plan on back taxes, but by law, Wayne County Treasurer had to charge you 18% on the payment plan. We got that reduced to 6%. We also put a cap on how much they could charge you for the outstanding amount. If it was more than the value of the house, we're able now to bring that down to 50% of the value of the house. So efforts are being made to keep people in their homes, to keep people in the neighborhood so that we're not pushing people out. We targeted those commercial areas in each of those areas I mentioned so that they don't leave those neighborhoods to go other places to have to shop. A lot of times people move just because there's no support services there. Can't go to the cleaners, can't go to specialty shops, can't go to a sit-down restaurant. We're changing that on the strip malls to keep residents in the neighborhood. So I see a little bit opposite from what other people see, that I don't think there is this outward full gentrification. If you look at what the Illiches are doing with the new stadium they're building down there, very few people still down there. And so the people that are, if there is housing, which there will be as a part of that project, 20% of it's got to be affordable, so that a lot of those people, in fact, can move back into that area, which is, I think, going to be thriving. If you talk about Brush Park, everything that Sue Mosey had to do here in Midtown had to have 20% affordable housing. It just doesn't get the story. The press just isn't going there. They're living in there. There's people with affordable housing in there. We got some Section 8 people in Midtown. It just doesn't make the news. It doesn't make the story because it's not sexy to do that. It's better to talk about gentrification and who got moved out. And so there's a more complete picture, as Ken said earlier, of what's really going on in Detroit. We unfortunately are a segregated town. And so as I always tell Stephen's friend, Nolan Finley, he said, well, I don't see where the black people are. That's because you don't go where the black people are. Yeah, I tell him that every time I see him. I can take you all around town. You can do stories all day long and see nothing but African Americans are taken down in Southwest Detroit and Hispanic. There's people down there don't even speak English. He doesn't go down there and write the story about that. They have good communities, strong communities, great restaurants, good food, all down there. Are they downtown Midtown? Absolutely not, but it's because they don't want to be, not because they've been excluded. So I think you've got to look at a bigger picture of Detroit. See, when we start talking about gentrification, and if we're going to hold it true to the real definition of gentrification.
Ken, I want you to start by talking more about your neighborhood, which was my neighborhood 20 years ago, and I can remember, for instance, when the Woodbridge Tavern was a liquor store, I think it was, for a while.
I grew up in Midtown. I grew up right up the street from there.
It's changed. Yeah. And some of those changes, I think, lead people to believe that the people who were there for a long time can no longer afford to be there or are not welcome. Is that the case?
Yeah. So I think as it relates to my neighborhood, as I mentioned earlier, I mean, our neighborhood still continues to be very diverse, even from an economic standpoint. Now, I think there are some concerns and some fears about how long that's going to last, particularly as some of the development that was talked about earlier and which Charlie just mentioned, as that starts to move along Grand River, You know, I think there are some concerns about rising property values. And, you know, and I guess I disagree with Charlie to a certain extent because, I mean, I think we'd be fooling ourselves if we didn't admit gentrification is happening in a couple of key areas. I mean, in downtown, it's definitely happening. I can remember even reading an article in your paper, which I think ran either late last year or early this year, about some of the rising property values and rising rents in downtown, which now were resulting in what are really being called third wave new Detroiters, where you kind of had this phase of, initially you had some of the poor folks that got moved out to make way for young professionals, and now some of those young professionals are getting priced out because the rents are going up even more, and the people that are now coming in behind them they're the executives, they're the people that own the companies that they work at. So I think in downtown, yeah, it's definitely happening in certain areas. I can remember even as far back as about 2 years or so ago, shortly before I left city council, there was a senior citizen apartment building in the Capitol Park area, which was purchased by a private developer who wanted to go in a different direction in terms of going market rate. And a number of us on council were able to hold that development up in committee until certain commitments were made to preserve a certain number of those units for the senior citizen. But at the end of the day, most of those residents still wound up getting displaced. So that is real. Now, having said that, though, where I do agree with Charlie is I think you've got a couple of things that are going in Detroit's favor. While this may be happening, it's very early stage, and I think the real impacts are really only being felt in a couple of areas right now. And that really gives us the opportunity to try to do some creative things to address it. And I think that Charlie's absolutely right that one of the things that Detroit has working in its favor right now, in addition to the fact that this is still a fairly early trend right now, is also the fact that I think city leadership recognizes it and is already taking proactive steps to deal with it. I mean, he talked about 20%. I know of one particular development right here in Midtown, just a couple blocks away, which is the Strathmore development on West Alexandria, just west of Woodward Avenue, where that was a project that got a certain amount of city incentives. And as a component of that, the city actually advocated that a minimum of 40% of the units in that building be priced affordable. So I think when you have city leadership that recognizes the need to protect Detroiters, people who are already here, that's a big help. You've got a mayor that gets it. I think you've got a city council that gets it. And that gives us the ability to really start being creative, given that a lot of this stuff is early on, to start thinking about creative approaches to protect longtime Detroiters.
So, I took oh so many notes. I feel like gentrification is a term oversimplifies it. It makes it something that's just for like academics and people to pontificate over. It's easy to dismiss, oh, that gentrification thing. But talking about displacement, like as you were talking, that building's called the Alfred. If anybody wanted to Google that story where the senior citizens were forced out. There are legitimate stories of housing developments where actual human beings had to leave to make room for new, higher paid human beings. Yep. Like, it's actually happening, and to say that gentrification isn't a concern for us, to me, ensures that it's going to happen. Like, don't pay attention to that. Never mind that. Never mind that tidal wave over there. Like, it's going to get to us. We're not at a DC level yet. We're not at Brooklyn yet. We're not at Portland yet. But if we don't do anything about it, we will be. And I don't think it's completely okay. Everybody needs a little piece of this action. Like, all the native Detroiters that are here aren't here because we got stuck. I know that my parents, for instance, stayed. They were in their same house on the northwest side of Detroit for 50 years. They stayed past several waves of flight to the suburbs, and they didn't leave because they couldn't. They wanted to stay. Homeownership is like a linchpin of intergenerational wealth. They're like, we own this. Why are we going to start over and start paying rent somewhere else? We're going to give this to you. So people stay because they want to stay. Everybody that's here isn't trapped or shackled or, you know, beat down so much that we just can't go nowhere. No, we could go. A lot of us really stay because we like it and we want to see this place get better for everybody. Other notes. When you were talking about how... bless your heart. We were talking about how the stadium is coming and how, oh, there are no people down here. That's because the Illiches were playing the long game. They held on to those properties and kind of made sure that nobody else would live down here so that they could foresee a place where they could put a stadium. It's not like it just happened, people just cleared out. No, the developers were playing a long game and they got what they wanted. What else do I have? In Brush Park, my rent has gone up twice in 4 years, so I could get priced out. I'm a young urban professional. I would like to stay, but I may get priced out. Gentrification, I don't know. I could go to one of those new hot neighborhoods on the northwest side, back to where I came from, I guess. I think that gentrification is not the only thing that's clearing out neighborhoods. What cleared out the neighborhood that I grew up in is fear. So I said my parents left their neighborhood 2 years ago. They got held up in their house. That was the last draw. They're like, we stayed here past everything. But the gun to the head in the living room was just like the last thing. And they were the second to last longtime residents in the neighborhood. The people that lived there slightly longer than they did, like 52 years, also moved out. So there went the whole neighborhood. You drive by that neighborhood now, it looks like Beirut. It is not like the urban Pleasantville that I grew up in. So when we're talking about like things that clear out neighborhoods, it's not just like the G word, it's also like fear and crime and just people neglecting a place. And we talk about retention and attraction all the time. I think there's so much more attention paid to getting people to come here from somewhere else. My neighborhood was full of people that had paid property taxes and income taxes for half a decade. The city didn't care about that tax base. Like that, those are some legitimate people that were paying their bills, paying their dues. They were good stewards to the land. The guy next door to my parents died. They raked the lawn, they cleaned the snow, they shoveled the they were good citizens, and those are the people that we're losing in exchange for getting, I don't know, a hop cat. We just got to think about what we're putting our attention on.
Chris, you sort of work both sides of this issue. You're a native Detroiter, been here your whole life, but you're also a developer who's interested in taking properties in the city and improving them, either with commercial or residential properties. How does displacement play a role in that, and is that ever okay, or is it always something we should fear?
One, just sort of breaking this gentrification term down, or at least putting it in two silos. There is the one component where we talk about ownership. And so it's about owning the land. And then there's the other component as to what happens on that land, or who resides or who owns the business or runs the business on that particular piece of dirt. I give you two case studies to some extent, I'm directly involved in. My partner and I, we built a 63,000 square foot office building right at Mac and I-75. We own the land. We own the building. I would dare say that the majority of the people who work in that building probably are not Detroiters, and they're certainly not African American. And so it is certainly it was an economic development, that a very positive economic development, is providing a tax base for the city, created construction jobs, and you have two African Americans, one who actually lives in the city of Detroit, who owns the property. But the jobs that were created, the 200 or so people who work in there, are for the most part, because they're sort of high-skilled positions that is part of Wayne State School of Medicine. So you have students that are in there, which the vast majority of students at Wayne State School of Medicine are not African-American. And you have the professors and others, professionals who are highly skilled people who some may live in Detroit, but a lot who don't. Another case study is a development we're working on in Midtown. Working with Mayor Duggan and his administration, we have acquired and have been approved, and we purchased a piece of land on Woodward, probably one of the last Woodward frontages that's here in Midtown. And we will build a 68-unit market-rate apartment building. We will have 20% of that building that will be affordable. But unfortunately, this is from the economic development side as a developer, I can only afford 20% of that building to be affordable, or my numbers won't work. I will not be able to secure the financing, or nor will it be a profitable business endeavor. And so I have to have market rate rents at $1.82 a square foot, which might not mean anything to anybody here, really, in order to do that development without any city or state initiatives or incentives, I need to be able to charge $2.20 a square foot. I'm basically pro forma the project at $1.80, and I'm still short, and so I need city incentives. And so I can only afford the 20%. That's another situation where we will own it, but I would dare say, based on, and this will get to my last point, based on sort of the where Midtown is, what the amenities in Midtown are, who is attracted or who will be attracted to my building. And so it will probably not be, and although I will not try to steer, I want a good tenant. You have, as we talked about, Ms. Hood talked about Hopcat and some other, you know, which are great businesses. Do those type of businesses, are they attractive to a certain demographic? And so do certain people even want or would want to be necessarily in Midtown? And so when you start talking about the gentrification, we started getting into the neighborhoods. As we start, now I heard, this was years ago working in city council, there was a council member who was very upset, said we had too many wig shops on Livernois.
I don't know who that was.
Well, the reality of it is those wig shops, they're there because they're viable businesses, and there's a certain demographic that go into those wig shops and buy those wigs and the weaves and everything else. So to the extent as these neighborhoods change and those type of businesses start to go away, you know, that there is no Motor City Soul Food like you have a Myers and 7 Mile, or there is no wig shop, and then the different businesses are not necessarily, makes that neighborhood not really attractive to a certain demographic of people. And I saw this, I lived in Washington, D.C. for 5 years. I saw that happen in my old neighborhood, that when I go back to 12th and P, Logan Circle, there is not the type of things, you know, that, you know, really were, you know, really germane to or attracted to a certain demographic in the Washington, D.C. community. And so that is something I think we have to keep our eye on the ball as relates to that, that ultimately as you have certain people come in, they buy homes, they fix the homes up, they make this investment, they want that community also to have the very, you know, amenities that they like. And that amenity may be a microbrewery, that amenity may be a yoga studio, that amenity may be, you know, something truly dynamic, but does it then fit the amenities that some of the people who live there or, you know, or other people who may want to move there may say, well, that is, they don't necessarily have the things that I like. They don't have Teresa's. Which, you know, some people might know about Teresa's on 6 Mile, or the Boardroom. That's and for some people, that is their neighborhood tavern, is Teresa's in the Boardroom. And so lastly, I think we got to look at this in the context of what happened and what you saw in the South, where you had a lot of people who owned large tracts of land, and you had developers who came and gave them what they thought was a fair market value or price for some land, and they gave up that land. And so, in fact, they gave up opportunity, they gave up the ability to build something, and then something was built there that they could no longer afford to move into or back into. And so, you know, we have a situation here where I think there's still a lot of Detroiters, a lot of African-American Detroiters that still own property in this city. But certainly they're seeing an opportunity that someone will come and say, well, you know, we want to buy your property. And it looks like a good deal. They don't have the wherewithal to develop it themselves. And so I think one of the things that certainly the government can do is, in certain situations, versus somebody just selling for the cheap, and then now they don't have land ownership, they can't develop it. You know, there needs to be, and I think Charlie has really been involved in this, where there are mentor ventures and joint ventures on the development side, where you have people who own land, they are then teamed up and partnered up with people who want to come and co-develop these properties, and then making sure that you keep some amenities that in that development that makes it attractive to to everybody.
Chris, you touched on it a little bit in your last answer, and I want to stay there for a second, on incentives. Incentives to do development. We also are now seeing incentives to come live in Detroit. The Live Detroit program that has people moving into Midtown and downtown with subsidies from their employers and some other nonprofits is attracting new people. And what's the proper role, though, of incentives in development, both in terms of trying to make sure people are included and attracting new residents to the city?
Well, as a developer and doing residential development, I appreciate those incentives because that will help to ensure that my tenant base that my building will get filled up. Those incentives are being offered to people who they're working here, and I think it's a great program. Live Midtown, Live Downtown. They're giving incentives to people who want to purchase as well as people who want to rent. It is part of helping to repopulate the city, build our tax base. I think in that regard, you know, I really have no qualms with it, for the exception that, you know, that the people who actually work for those businesses who are participating certainly are people who are Detroiters. And to the extent that if these are Detroiters who are not working for those institutions or those businesses, then many Detroiters will not have an opportunity to take advantage of those incentives.
Right. Yeah, Stephen, if I might, I'm glad Chris hit that. I certainly don't want to take any food off his table. We have to be real careful about those kinds of incentives because he's absolutely right. I mean, if you look at Quicken Loans, if you look at the Little Caesars organization, you look at some of the larger employers downtown that in fact were offering these incentives, ain't a whole lot of Detroiters that are part of that. Matter of fact, they moved from the suburbs into Detroit, and of course a lot of them came kicking and screaming, which is why they had to do the incentives. And so if we're not careful, if we don't keep a close eye on those kinds of incentives, then we're going to perpetuate the issue of Detroit being nothing but young white professionals and white empty nesters. And the bottom line is that's who's moving back in Detroit. And the reality is folks, there's still more people leaving Detroit than is coming into Detroit.
Right.
So let's not get carried away here. Right. We're still losing population. But the people that are coming in are young professionals and empty nesters for the most part. We're trying to keep those who, as Lauren says, who really want to stay, and then those who have no choice but to stay, to improve their city services, to make their neighborhoods better, to provide them with more services, and ultimately jobs so that they can participate in the economic activity that goes on in Detroit. But we got to be careful about incentives and who gets them and at what level.
I would second a lot of what Charlie said on those incentive programs. Opportunity begets opportunity, right? So the people that qualify for those incentive programs already have a really good job at a really stable organization. You had to be at a certain level in the organization and have been there for a certain amount of time. So you've already got a lot of things going for you. Then on top of that, we're like, here's some money to move downtown or to live in Midtown. But I would like an incentive. I've been here for 43 years. What do I get? I had to work for everything, for really hard, overcoming a great many obstacles, being a woman, being a black person. I had a lot of privilege. I was middle class and pretty stable middle, but having to overcome personal challenges, like just to get somebody, I would like help staying in my Brush Park apartment. Where is my incentive? That's all I want to know. Where's the incentive for the people that have been here and toughed it out? And again, not maybe for the people that couldn't leave, can they have an incentive too? But the ones that wanted to stay, why do I have to go work for Quicken or Henry Ford Hospital or DMC or whatever the short list of, why should only those people be valued in living around here? It should just be open up to everybody.
Yeah, I agree with a lot of what's been said, so I'll try not to be redundant. I think the thing that we do have to keep first and foremost is that the ultimate incentive to either entice someone to come to a community or to stay in that community is to provide a high quality of life and a high standard of living. And I think we have to be candid in admitting that part of the reason why you see some of these incentive programs being created and being offered is because We ain't quite there yet. Charlie really hit the nail on the head when he talked about the city's population situation, and Ernie really kind of covered it in his intro. The reality is Detroit, at the height of its population back in the 1950s, was home to nearly 1.8 million people. Well, actually, it was 1.8 million people. Now, Detroit, at least according to some of the pre-census, mid-decade census numbers I've seen, we're at below 700,000 people. And yet we've still got a service delivery model that is very, very much still structured to service nearly 2 million people. So the reality is that part of how we can better serve our population is by growing that population. Because when you grow the population, you grow the tax base. So incentives can actually be an important mechanism for doing that. So from that standpoint, I really don't have a problem with them. However, I do agree with much of what's been said here and recognize that the discussion of incentives really needs to be broadened. At Detroit Future City, we have a steering committee and an executive committee. And in one of the meetings of one of those bodies about a week or so ago, one of our members actually said something in response to a comment that was made about attracting new Detroiters. And his point was very powerful, and it stuck with me. I'm going to repeat it with you, which is that when we talk about bringing in new Detroiters, that tells me, as a longtime Detroiter, that I'm not important. And you know, that's a real sentiment that we have to recognize and acknowledge and deal with for what it is. So this discussion of incentives does in fact need to be broadened in such a way that we talk about doing things for those that have stuck it out through the high times, the low times, and all the times in between. And in some respects, those folks, not only do they have equal value, you could argue they should be valued more.
I just have one more thing on incentives. I always think of that like Sears ad campaign, like take a look at us now. Whenever I hear about an incentive program, I'm like, oh, there's Detroit doing that shuffle and sambo. Take a look at us now. Why, if you are not ready for Detroit the way it is, then don't come here yet. Why do we need to get you here? Stop hemorrhaging people from my neighborhood who are a tax base. I don't need you here if you are not ready for us as we are, is my opinion.
Broader fan club here.
I want to quickly turn to community benefits agreements. That's been a subject of real argument in Detroit for not just recently, but for a very long time. We've had community benefits agreements for a long time in Detroit with most big projects. A lot of them have not done what they should to keep communities intact. But the question I want to ask is whether community benefits agreements are a foil to gentrification. Is that one of the ways that we make sure that, that people who have been here for a long time are taken care of, and that when new people come in, that there is some benefit, some direct benefit to them from that influx of new people and money? We'll start at the other end with Charles.
Good. That's a hot topic that's going around lately, and there's a huge discussion, of course, at City Council now on whether or not we should have community benefits agreements, and then what form that they take. Let's make no mistake about this, and I think most of the council people, and I certainly know the Duggan administration, believes that every major deal that happens in Detroit, there should be a benefit to the community. No question about that. The challenge comes in as to how we implement that. And so there's a camp that says that it should be an ordinance, which in fact is close to a law, so that every developer that comes through here has to negotiate with every single group and interest group that is in the area that this development is going to happen. What developers will tell you, and Chris knows this from around the country and around the world, they're not coming here if they have to do that. If they've got to sit down with six or seven different groups with different ideas, different approaches, different CDC here, a neighborhood association there, and that's what's being proposed, it will add sometimes 6, 8, 9, 10 months. You need Marvin Beatty to tell you about what he had to go through to do the development at 8 Mile Myers, and you all know how long it took that thing to go on. That's because he was busy having to negotiate with every separate equal. So what we want to do is to be competitive in bringing major developments to Detroit. And part of what that is for developers is, how can they come in and put their deal together quickly and get up and running and start some cash flow, which then helps the economy for us. And so what the administration's side of this proposal is, that let's have a community benefits agreement. Let's make sure that it's a part of the deal once it comes to city council, but let it be a policy, not an ordinance. And let me give you an example of that. And Donald and his wife left, but 30, 40 years ago when Coleman Young was the mayor, we had a, it wasn't called that then, but it was a policy. And the point was, is that it was a policy that he instilled every time, that developers were afraid to come to Detroit and not put a proposal together where there wasn't significant community benefit for the wrath of Coleman Young, because it came from the leadership. It came from the president of city council, who was Carl Levin at the time, where it was a policy that that's what you had to do. And that worked. Some of the developments that you see around town now were all done without having a community benefits ordinance. So all we're saying is community benefits are very important and are a must, quite frankly. But it's how you implement it. If we put something together that makes us less competitive with Columbus and Toledo and Chicago and Pittsburgh and other those other places, we're not going to see the kind of development that we need to see that creates the Chris Jacksons and the Jim Jenkins and the others, because they're not coming here. They've been very clear about that. And Chris may want to deal with this point. So that's really what this whole community benefits argument's about. It's gotten skewed, and everybody thinks it's one side or another saying that there shouldn't be benefits for the community. That is not what we're saying. It's how we implement it and how we maintain our competitive nature with other cities who are trying to get those same developers to come to their town to do housing and plants, construction, and everything else. And so I want to say it loud and clear, the Duggan administration is all for community benefits. There's no question about it.
Yeah, and I'm actually glad to hear that, because I personally support community benefits agreements, and everything that Charlie said is consistent with what I've heard, which is that both generally the mayor and the council are on the same page, and everybody wants community benefits agreements. It's just a question of what's the best way to get the train to the destination, and that's, you know, the fact that there's at least a general agreement, I think, is huge. To the heart of your question, Stephen, I do think that community benefits agreements are important, and I do think it's part of the solution, because community benefits, what they will do and what they can ensure is that on some of these big ticket projects, that not only do you have a certain amount of the contractual work associated with the construction and development of these projects going to Detroit-based businesses and firms, but also that the long terms created as a result will also accrue to Detroiters. And it's important, because we have seen a number of instances over the years where some of these projects have come to Detroit, and you know, you hear the promises made and discussion about reasonable best efforts, and the reasonable best efforts don't really yield a whole lot. Case in point was the, you know, the Marathon project, the refinery down in Southwest Detroit, which a lot of people don't know, but that, at the time that project was announced, you look at the amount of money that's being put into it, it is actually the biggest economic development project, not just in the cities, but in Wayne County's history, in terms of the amount of dollars that are being spent there. And there were promises made to not only hire Detroiters, but to hire a certain number of people directly from that zip code 48217, and they haven't been delivered on. They have not been met. So from that standpoint, I do think that community benefits agreements are a partial solution. This is a bigger issue. I mean, there's other matters out there that we gotta deal with, like concentration of poverty. Charlie talked earlier about the educational challenges that we face in DPS and here in the city of Detroit. But I do think that one of the important things that we can't lose sight of, and I'll try to be as quick as possible, and I think part of the reason why I wound up being invited to actually speak at this panel is because I participated in a similar forum back in January, and prior to participating in that forum, I had actually called up George, who's the reason we're all here tonight, and I had wanted to kind of just sit down and, you know, pick his brains on this subject of gentrification, because he's always somebody that I have respected in terms of his business acumen and the way he does things. And his take, I hope you don't mind me sharing it, is that he talked about how he developed this place and how he basically saw, or rather foresaw, what was coming and then positioned himself to take advantage of it. So I do think that at the end of the day, when we talk about gentrification, George's lesson is one that we should really all learn from, All too often, the discussion of gentrification, it starts from a place of fear, and that's really not where we ought to be starting it. We should be starting it from a standpoint or from a place of curiosity about how we can maybe seize the opportunity that it presents, because that's how you really begin to get things like what George has developed here, like what Chris has done with Queen Lillian. More of our people need to be doing that. We need to be trying to foresee where's going to be the next hot area that's going to pop and start thinking in terms of buying and acquiring property there. I mean, the way I look at it is if you know that the wave is coming, you got two choices. You can either get drowned by it or you can surf it.
Ooh, drop the mic, walks off.
What'd she say?
I said drop the mic, walks off. CBAs.
No fan club didn't count for that.
It's so multi-layered. So I was working with the group Corridors Alliance in the CAS corridor to get a CBA with the Illiches over the development of the arena. But there are other organizations that are doing so much more work, like Linda Campbell at People's Platform. You should talk to Reverend Ross in the North End. Like, those people have been at the forefront of trying to get this ordinance passed, and I totally agree, and yes, we should have it. And I feel like if there are developers that wouldn't want to come do business here because we have that ordinance, then maybe we don't need them either. Can we think of a new model of development and not just, maybe we don't need that kind of big box development. Maybe we can think of something else. We're just so programmed to think about development in one way. Can we challenge ourselves to unplug from the matrix and like be creative? Maybe there's a different way to do it. Just maybe.
You know, I'm actually accustomed to, in this community benefit agreement term, is, you know, if people think that this is something that is new. But as Charlie had mentioned, development agreements between a developer and the municipality is something that has been taking place, you know, over 30 or so years or more here in the city of Detroit. Ken, former Councilman Ken Cockrel, was involved in two projects, major projects, that I was part of, where we had development agreements. Yeah. One was Greektown Casino. Yeah. It was very successful. We had a requirement of hiring at least 50% of the employees had to be Detroit residents, current Detroit residents. We had some requirements relative to construction. Relative to hiring or hiring minority-owned and women-owned businesses. And so those development agreements, it had teeth in it. It had punitive damages, in fact, if we did not, abide by that agreement. My Queen Lillian project, in fact, we had a development agreement, which was very similar as far as it focused more on the construction jobs. I agree with Ms. Hood in that, I mean, I think developers, though, need to come to the table, first of all, instead of having their arm twisted. People do need to come here wanting to help the city, wanting to provide opportunity for Detroiters, wanting to hire Detroit-based architectural and construction companies and engineers. I mean, that should not be something they should have to be browbeated in order to get them to come in here to take advantage of these very incentives, because the development agreements are tied to the incentives. The city council is saying, if we're going to give you the tax breaks, if we're going to give you the brownfield and the Oprahs and all these things, then you have to make a commitment of what you're going to give back to the city. We have been fortunate in that when we came to the table with Greektown Casino, with Queen Lillian's development, I had a African-American contractor, African-American architectural firm with Queen Lillian. We use engineering firms, you know, Detroit-based, women-owned companies that we already had selected day one before we even signed a development agreement. And so I agree that there needs to be a new attitude that when developers and business people come to Detroit, yes, it needs to be profitable, but also, I mean, you got to hire somebody to build it. You got to hire somebody to do the architectural. You got to hire an electrician and a plumber and a carpenter. And why not use Detroit-based companies? I mean, we got plenty of them here. As it relates to it being an ordinance or it just remaining as a development agreement, I mean, I really don't, you know, I think that the development agreement model has worked. I think there are some things that are part of the ordinance component relative to hiring people within the certain zip codes that in order to have them working on the particular job. I think there's a direct conflict with the unions because the city makes us as developers hire or hire union companies, be it a carpenter or electrician, but the people who are in that union don't live in that zip code where I'm building my building. And so at some point, you know, I think the people who are pushing the ordinance have to make a decision. Do they want to please the union, or do they want to have truly have people from that zip code working on that job, or they got to get the unions to hire or bring into their union membership people who live in that zip code? That's one of the things that's sort of missing in the discussion. And so you don't hear, and I'm not anti-union, but you know, I prefer to hire somebody where I'm building my building near Mack and Woodward. But is that person in the carpenters union? Are they in the electrical union? They can't just walk off the street and come get on our job. They gotta come through the union. And so is the union doing the outreach in that zip code at Mack and Woodward, bringing those individuals into their union so they can participate? So I just think that's something that needs to also be part of that discussion.
Okay, we're going to start with the audience questions, and if I'm going to read the question. If it's your question, if you want, you can raise your hand and say it was yours, and dialogue with the panel if you want. If you don't want to do that, you don't have to. So the first one is, there's a lot of overpopulation in Midtown and CBD. Developers in these major markets are almost asking Chicago rates without density. If you want independent and not chains, they need to be more creative with build out and with rent. Whose question is that?
Seems like a comment, really.
Who wants to address that?
A question.
It's not really a question now.
That's kind of a comment, not a
question. If you want like New York style businesses, Chicago independent businesses, which can happen, and sure you're going to have the national change. It's going to be atypical of the growth in Detroit, but I think. And having it, had a small business in Midtown for 10 years, and we were successful. We had the Atlas Bistro. I think there needs to be an understanding of what the small businesses need. There need to be more creative incentives for really unique businesses to stay within. And that can be retail, that can be anything, art. But in order to have like the Sohos and, you know, the interesting, like Andersonville in Chicago, you need to have, I think, more incentives. And I think some, and nothing against developers, I think some of them are missing the market. And I just, it's an opinion, but I just think the rates are excessive right now, so.
And just to piggyback on me saying that, you know, in my development, for instance, we have 15,000 square feet of retail space that'll be on the first floor. Well, based on, you know, the numbers of my project, I have to charge X rent to a retail establishment in order to make my pro forma work. Well, that X number is way too much for the independent retailer who wants to come and be a tenant in the building. And so there does need to be something to help equal out that playing field, because then I can only really talk to some of these major corporations who have the ability, the wherewithal to pay those higher rents. I think that's...
If I can add too, a lot of the foundations, and there's nothing to no emotion here, go directly to the developers with a lot of these funds, and I think they should get down on the ground now. They're 10,000 feet above. We've come down to 1,000 feet. We should be walking on the ground with these. And not even us, we're not really interested in reopening, but just other people I talk to as a commercial broker, they need incentives. I mean, some of these people don't have the capital, you know, they have capital to get in, but they don't want to sign personal guarantees on their life. And so if we can get some of the foundations to get on the ground with these independents, I mean, I think it would really help keep things
subsidies,
diversified.
Not necessarily an incentive.
Right.
Subsidy.
Right.
Okay. Next audience question. What's being done to promote awareness to communities that will soon have developments in their areas? Whose question is that?
That's the question.
What's the city doing?
Well, we've got a few things we're doing. I mean, obviously the capacity of the city is limited just coming out of bankruptcy, but this mayor is pretty pretty innovative with the things he's doing. And so if anybody frequents the city website, and Ken's familiar with it, DetroitMI.gov, we're doing a lot of things there. I mean, it's certainly way above my technological understanding, but there's all kinds of applications on that website, marketing, the auctions that we do. You can go on that website now and find out just about anything that we're doing, in what area, economic development opportunities that are coming, the purchasing and job opportunities that are coming. You can look at every house that's coming up for auction. You can look at every house that may be next door on your block, when it's going to be demolished, what date. So we're trying to get the word out as much as possible about what we're doing in the city, both good and bad. Very soon you'll be able to lodge your complaints and concerns. If it's an inoperative fire hydrant, to somebody didn't show up to pick up the trash, whatever, you'll be able to go to an application, put it in the system, and it'll come back to you with the date on which that's going to get done. You can always check on that. So we're doing some of those kinds of things, but again, they're limited just based upon the capacity of the city, but it's much more than we used to do. And then, you know, the media's got to start, you know, jumping on some of this stuff. They, and it's no offense to my nephew down there, they do what they do, but they're only going after the stories that they think are popular for them. I mean, there's some good stories. We haven't got them yet to go down to Cuzzo's on Live North somehow and do a story down there. Or my man who left, who was at the Addison building there. I mean, there's a new restaurant back in there since he left. How about a story on that? How about a story on Hot Sam's downtown? It's one of the oldest retail stores that happens to be African-American owned in downtown. No story on that. How about Floods, Bar and Grill, African-American business, middle-class folks going down there for years. No story on that. Right. I mean, there's all kinds of things that the media could help us with marketing on if they just really wanted to and started pushing Detroit. We hear all about the bad stuff, and that's good, but how about some of the good things that are going on? We've targeted Livernois 7 Mile and the commercial area down there. I'm hoping that we'll bring some stories there. I, for one, personally decided that it's an embarrassment to have the most affluent area of our city, the most solid tax base. And we got University District, Sherwood Forest, Palmer Woods, Green Acres, and they have no decent retail strip down there. So we're going to change that. And so we're making a concentrated effort to do it. I'm hoping that the media will talk about that so that nobody knows that, so it won't be a secret anymore. So marketing is expensive if you have to do it yourself. But, you know, we've got some of the best marketers around, Detroit News, the Free Press, Michigan Chronicle. Just come down, tell the story.
Well, you know, my response to that question, I would say, and my advice to anybody that wants to get a sense of development trends, particularly within your respective neighborhoods, and I'm actually kind of surprised you didn't mention this, and I hope you're not selling yourself and your colleagues short, but is the Department of Neighborhoods. You know, the mayor's created the Department of Neighborhoods, and now every city council district has a district manager and deputy district manager. And those folks are very, very plugged in about what is going on within their district, including development trends. And I found, at least in our dealings with them at Future City, that they really can be an excellent resource in terms of if you want to know what development is happening within my district, how does that impact me? Something else I would also recommend is get to know the various organizations in your community. And I'm not just talking about block clubs or community associations. But in particular, if your neighborhood or your area has a CDC, and by CDC, I'm not talking about Citizens District Council, I'm talking about community development corporations. You do have a number of nonprofit community development corporations throughout the city who have been, and in many cases continue to be, active players in development projects within their neighborhoods. One example, is the Core City Neighborhoods, which is on the near west side, which developed a number of housing properties in that particular part of town. Another example is, it used to be Warren Connor Development Coalition. They changed their name to Eastside Community Network shortly before the end of last year. That's another organization that has actually developed both commercial and residential projects over the years. So I'd suggest also finding out if there are such entities in your neighborhoods, getting to know them, find out what they're working on. Another really good example, I'll just say this and then I'll stop, is Vanguard, which is a CDC, which is, their headquarters is actually on East Grand Boulevard, just a couple blocks to the east of Woodward Avenue. I know I was in a meeting with them last year where they were actually talking about plans that they had to redevelop and preserve that area, especially because of their proximity to Midtown. They were thinking in terms of, look, not everybody's going to be able to get into Midtown, and as rents and property values continue to rise, folks are going to be looking for the next area. And they believed that they were well positioned and were already developing a plan to take advantage of that. So find out if there are organizations like that within your respective neighborhoods.
I just want to just add, and you know, Charlie and the administration are doing so many things, but there's one major initiative that is really going to touch the neighborhoods, and I think anybody in here who's an entrepreneur who's looking at doing a business within one of the major commercial corridors in the city, it's called the Motor City Match. Yep. I sit on the EDC board, the Economic Development Corporation board for the city, and Ernie talked about these block grants that we used to get from the federal government, and a lot of that money used to go into the big projects like the Chrysler plant and the General Motors plant. Well, the mayor has actually then reprogrammed, it's not a big number, but it's $4.5 million of that money every year committed for the next 5 years that comes to the EDC just to spur economic development along the major business corridors, commercial corridors throughout the city. So that's 7 Mile, 6 Mile, Connor, Harper, Grand River, and it is for that independent entrepreneur who either has a building but may not have a business, and is matching up someone with a business who doesn't have a building, and is giving technical assistance and support to get a business, be it a coffee shop or a print shop or something like that, off the ground. And so I actually applaud the administration. That's a major initiative where it's now moving out of, you know, the city core into these commercial corridors where most of the Detroiters really live, where we don't have the retail, where we don't have the commercial retail. So Motor City Match, it is online. It is something, I think, at least a step forward. Now, I will caution, as we're talking about gentrification today, is that who will take advantage of that program? And that is, you know, I think that's where the rubber meets the road, that at some point, that if you have people who are not necessarily the Detroiters that are already here, who go and take advantage of that, then, you know, that to some extent is shame on Detroiters, but we need to educate ourselves, get involved in that, because those are type of programs that are there, and you want to be get in and be a part of it. And so I'm certainly going to push for that as a member of the Economic Development Corporation Board, making sure that Detroiters first are the ones who are participating in that program.
Okay, before we go to the next question, I'm going to push back a little against my Uncle Charles. I just did a little Googling. Just a little Googling, and there's a story just January 30th about Cuzo's at 6 Mile Liberty.
All right, all right.
Director.
I stand corrected.
A little glimpse of what it'll be like at our Thanksgiving day. The next question is, I hear about reserving 20% of affordable housing, but we spend, can we spend some of that money to help people raise their incomes? Obviously, poverty is a big driver of the problems that we have in Detroit, and it's one of the things that that's affected by gentrification. It's one of the ways that people get left behind. What are some of the things we're going to do policy-wise to deal with that end of it?
Whose question is that, by the way?
That's the question I was asking, because I hear a lot of the conversation, and I think things are being done as well to raise people's income, but in the conversation, I hear about affordable housing, we're going to reserve 20% for affordable housing, and sometimes I think, I don't know, I would love to hear more conversation about how to raise people's income so they can afford to live.
Right, so they don't, right, and so they can afford to live in these places. We also have the mass movement of the black middle class that lived in Detroit who moved to the suburbs, and they don't see the value that other people are seeing. That's also a source that sometimes is not tapped into because they moved. And so, I think there are other avenues.
Well, and I'll just briefly say, just so everyone is clear, when you say affordable housing, because a lot of people always are thinking vouchers, or you're thinking, some people it may come to mind the projects or something like that. Affordable housing is based on 80% of the median income in Wayne County. So, in fact, you can have a Detroit police officer, maybe a school teacher at a charter school because they're not paying a lot, with a couple kids who very well could fit into that that demographic as far as affordable housing based on what, you know, the federal government and these incentive programs. And so it's not necessarily low income. I agree with you. I mean, that is something that, you know, is way above us. You know, there's a discussion taking place in Washington about increasing wages and that kind of thing. I wish, from a selfish perspective, that we had higher incomes in this region where I could charge more rent, frankly. Even people who are considered middle class, I can only go to $1.82 a square foot, which is still, 50 cent way below where I need to be in any other middle class community, even around the country. And so, to the extent that incomes do go up, I think it's better for everybody. I think that is the dance that everybody is doing now. I mean, you have the unions pushing for that. It's something that I think is, I don't know any of us up here that we have any control over it. But
yeah, and simultaneously we have high-end jobs that aren't being filled because you can't find people to fill them. And so some of this money that goes into subsidizing, and it's long-term, this is shorter term, but also when you try to solve problems and you just think in the short term as opposed to the long term, then the problem still will reoccur. So that's, they can't fill certain jobs, and then we're still looking to subsidize. Right. It seems to me, the math is
there's a gap. Well, you're absolutely right, but there's another group that works very closely with Ken, Detroit Economic Detroit Employment Solutions Corporation, headed up by Pam Moore. She gets $60 million a year out of the federal government to do job training. She's running thousands of Detroiters through that program every day to train them for some of the high-tech jobs and more complex jobs that are coming. That's been one of the big problems. I mean, particularly, and Chris knows this, in construction, it's all skilled trade. We don't have a lot of Detroiters and African-Americans in skilled trades. So we need to break into that part of the area and get more apprenticeship programs and more journeyman programs to that. So we're trying to address it, but you're talking about a city that, depends on which day you count it, is 25% to 30% unemployment. Young folks from 18 to 24 is probably closer to 50%. And so there's a massive training effort that has to go on, but we're addressing it person by person as well as we can. But Pam's doing a great job over there. She's got installations all around the city, east side, west side, southwest, so nobody can claim that they can't get to where she is because they're on every side of the town. So we're coming. Again, it's something that you wouldn't necessarily know about, and we need to do a better job of getting the word out. She does do good marketing. She's got a lot of partnerships with Wayne County Community College, and some of the things that we're doing. So slowly but surely, we're getting there. I know that the Michigan Economic Development Corporation and Mike Finney has done a lot of training programs, a lot of initiatives. They've been working with Detroit Manufacturing Systems over on the west side. They're hiring the chronically unemployed with training. We were over on Grand River Rosa Parks the other day, and the young lady over there, what's the name of the group? Can't remember it now, but the ladies make jewelry.
The lady that makes
the jewelry out of graffiti.
Oh, that's my neighbors.
And she only hires welfare mothers and unemployed folks.
What is it?
Yes. And so there's efforts like that that are going on to hire folks who even traditionally haven't had a consistent job. So we're addressing it, but it's a massive problem. But you know, again, with the help of a lot of folks, and the state, and the feds, and foundations who want to chip in, we're knocking away at it step by step.
Okay, we're going to take one last question, I think, before we adjourn. What development apprenticeships, internships, programs are offered for youth? That's a good question. How do you get more people who are living in the city, who are natives, involved at the development level in the city's comeback?
Well, I'll just say real briefly, my partner and I, we hire Detroit Public School students to intern in our office throughout the whole year. Even in the summer, we have at least two kids pretty much all throughout the year, and they get an opportunity to see both what we do as development, what we do in construction, allowing them to, you know, have this, even if they somewhere down the road have no idea or don't want to be involved in construction or development, they're at least exposed to it and the various components of it. So I think certainly that's something more, hopefully more Detroit businesses would do that. I know the mayor has an initiative that Charlie will probably talk about, matching up a lot of corporate entities with Detroit youth.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. We have a youth employment program that's coming up this summer. And I forget the acronym for it, what the name is, but Ken talked about my district managers that are out there. One of the things they're being evaluated on is how many businesses, both downtown and in the neighborhoods, that they can get to hire Detroit youth. And it's a great program, because if they agree to do it, we've got money in the pot. We pay half the cost. So the corporations are jumping on that. Our aim is to have over 500 this year and to add another 500 every year for youth employment in Detroit. So again, step by step, we're really trying to get there.
I wasn't going to mention any programs specifically, but I was going to say if you want more people in the neighborhoods to be civically engaged, you have to meet people where they're at. So I love that this event is here, but like the collective knowledge in this room, everybody in here knows about all the programs. So if each one of you would take a trip to another neighborhood and share that with some other people, then you could get people in the neighborhoods to know about things. Everybody down here knows about all the stuff. We just have to spread the knowledge.
Very good point. Yes.
Okay, I want to thank our panel for their insights and their time. And thank George for convening us here.
Thank you, and thank the panel. Very lively discussion there. I want to add one thing, though. You know, I had to do this, right? Is that a lot of things you could really just do yourself. I'm a believer in not getting stuck on, like, what kind of program I can get in, or who's doing, or who's not doing something. I always say, like, if 10 of you get a neighborhood and say, there's 10 vacant houses here, we're going to all buy them for $1,000. Everybody get a house. You have changed that neighborhood just by y'all working on that house. So you can do your own revitalization plan without spending months of time going through some type of program that you may not ever get the money for, because you're not going to be solid enough. So always think about yourself. Think ahead.
That's right.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to kind of note something. When I talk to people about gentrification, I always say it's revitalization, not gentrification. You want to focus on that, because revitalization doesn't exclude anyone, and you don't need as much capital to make your neighborhood better.
All right. Well, thank you very much for coming in. And just for 1 minute, we have Ms. Aldrich here to give a couple of announcements.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming out today. We really appreciate your attendance. Can you hear me? I'm new to this. I'm not a public speaker. I'm Taylor Aldridge. I'm the program coordinator here. So I coordinated this event. I really appreciate your attendance. Next Friday, we're going to have an opening in conjunction with the Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo show at the DIA entitled Mundo Americas. So we have our opening, it's gonna be from 6 to 9 p.m., so please come out for that. We'll have refreshments, drinks, chips, some food for you to nibble on. And there's going to be the third and final installment of this panel on April 16th from 6 to 9 p.m. as well. So we look forward to seeing you all there again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's good to see you.
Thank you.